Good evening, and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. I'm Deborah England, Senior Program Officer at the Corrette Foundation, and your chair for the program. Tonight's program is part of the club's American Values series, underwritten by the Toby Family Foundation. We also welcome our listeners on the radio and invite everyone to visit us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. And now, it is my pleasure to introduce our distinguished speaker, Timothy Sandefur, adjunct scholar at the CATO Institute, attorney at the Pacific Legal Foundation, and author of the new book, The Right to Earn a Living, Economic Freedom and the Law. In addition to the bona fides I just mentioned, Timothy is also the lead attorney at the Foundation's Economic Liberty Project. He's working to protect businesses against abusive government regulations. In February 2006, he became one of the youngest attorneys ever featured on the cover of California Lawyer magazine. He's a frequent guest on radio and television programs, including the Armstrong and Getty Show, the Jim Lehrer NewsHour, and NPR's This American Life. He's the author of two books, Cornerstone of Liberty, Property Rights in 21st Century America, and The Right to Earn a Living, Economic Freedom and the Law. He's published more than 40 scholarly articles on subjects ranging from eminent domain and economic liberty to evolution and creationism, copyright law, and the legal issues of slavery and the Civil War. His articles have also appeared in National Review Online, the Claremont Review of Books, Forbes Online, and other venues. Please welcome Timothy Sandefur.
Well, thank you very much. I'm very honored to be here, and thank you to the Toby Foundation for financing and supporting this event tonight. I am very honored to be speaking at such a prestigious institution, and to be back in San Francisco. I love visiting San Francisco. I live in Sacramento. And, you know, as you probably know, the fun thing to do in Sacramento is go to San Francisco and do something fun. So, and one of the fun things that I did a few years ago was litigate a case here in San Francisco in the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, where I represented a client named Alan Merrifield. Mr. Merrifield actually works over in San Mateo, I believe, and he runs a pest control business. He's been in the pest control business for decades now. He doesn't deal with pesticides and bugs and insects and stuff. He deals with pigeons and rats and mice and things like that. And he doesn't use chemicals because he thinks that they're dangerous, they're not very effective, people don't like them, you know. He uses structural devices, like, you know, those spikes that people put on buildings to keep pigeons from landing on them, things like that. He has a device called the, sounds terrible, it's called the bird blaster. But it doesn't hurt the bird. What it does is it uses like radar or something to detect a bird landing on a building. And then it sprays compressed air through a flexible hose. It goes psh, like that. Scares the heck out of the bird, right? Bird flies away. Bird's not hurt. Everybody's happy, right? Well, in California, if you want to put spikes on a building or the bird blaster on a building or something to keep pigeons away, you first have to have a Branch 2 structural pest control operator's license. And to get a license requires you to go through 2 years of training learning how to use, store, and handle pesticides. And then take a 200-question multiple-choice exam on the use, storage, and handling of pesticides. Now, I have read this examination, and I'm actually under a court order not to disclose to you what's on that examination. But I can tell you what's not on that exam. There's not a single question on it about pigeons, and there's not a single question on it about spikes. Nevertheless, under California law, Mr. Merrifield would be required to shut down his business for 2 years and become an apprentice, learning how to store and handle and use pesticides in order to take a test that tests his knowledge of stuff he doesn't even need to know. And it gets better, because the law only applies if you're dealing with pigeons. If you put the same spikes on the same building to keep seagulls away, you don't need any license at all. So, we at the Pacific Legal Foundation filed a lawsuit against this law. We said this law is ridiculous. And we challenged this law under the 14th Amendment. Now, I'm sure you all have your constitutions with you, so if you'll pull those out. The 14th Amendment to the Constitution guarantees your right to the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States, your right not to be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, and your right to the equal protection of the laws. And we argued that this law violated all three of these clauses. Now, the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States, what does that refer to? Well, it's a technical legal term that includes the rights that belong to you by natural law and by the common law tradition, the Anglo-American common law tradition that we inherited from England when we were colonies. And one of the oldest rights that's respected by the common law history is the right to earn an honest living for yourself and your family without unreasonable government interference. The oldest case that I have found on this dates back to the 14th century when an English court struck down a law restricting the sale of wine in London. But this whole Whig anti-monopoly tradition really got off the grounds in the 17th century in a series of cases decided by one of my heroes, the greatest lawyer of all time, Sir Edward Coke. Edward Coke started out as the Attorney General for Queen Elizabeth and ended up becoming Chief Justice of England in the 17th century. And he believed that every English subject had the right to earn a living without unreasonable interference from the government. And in a series of decisions, he started striking down these royal monopolies. Now, royal monopolies were where the King of England would sell you the exclusive right to do a certain business. Like, only you would be allowed to make and sell playing cards, for example. And it would be illegal for anybody else to make and sell playing cards. And that, in fact, is the fact situation in one of the most famous cases of the era, a case called the Case of Monopolies, or Darcy versus Allen, that involved a monopoly on the sale of playing cards. And the court struck this monopoly down and said it violated the Magna Carta's Law of the Land Clause, the Law of the Land Clause, which we today call the Due Process Clause of the United States Constitution. And the Supreme Court of England, the Court of King's Bench, started striking down these monopoly restrictions. My favorite case of this period, actually, is a case called the Case of the Upholsterers. It was illegal to practice the trade of upholstery unless you first had a license from the Upholstery Guild. Now, this guy wanted to go into the business of upholstery, and he didn't have a certificate from the Upholsterers Guild, so he's brought up on charges. It goes up to the Court of King's Bench. And what did the Upholstery Guild say? Did they say, well, the reason for this restriction is to keep an artificial scarcity in the marketplace so that we can raise our prices, not having to really compete for customers, so we can charge customers more and keep entrepreneurs and competition out? Of course they didn't say that, right? They said what these groups always say. They said, well, this restriction protects the general public. From what? From bad upholstery, I guess, you know. You might sit down in a chair and there'd be like a tack sticking out or something, and so we have this law in place. And Lord Coke, who by this time was Chief Justice of England, said, this is ridiculous. Actually, he said, no skill there is in this, for a man might learn it in 6 hours. And then in one of my favorite lines from any court opinion, he said, unskillfulness is sufficient punishment. Right? If you're bad at your job, that's punishment enough. You know, customers won't shop from you, and so you'll suffer. And there's no reason for the government to be involved. As long as you're not hurting somebody, you know, then it's up to you to be good at your trade. So these cases established a common law tradition of the right of economic liberty that the founding fathers understood, because Lord Coke, after he was fired from the Court of King's Bench for resisting royal tyranny during the Stuart monarchy, In fact, there's a sculpture of him on the front door of the United States Supreme Court building in Washington. After Lord Coke was fired, he wrote a series of legal textbooks that were the only law school books for the founding fathers' generation. Thomas Jefferson and James Madison and all of the founding father lawyers got their start by reading Lord Coke's textbooks. And he says in these books over and over again, every individual has the right to earn an honest living without unreasonable government interference. And the founding fathers called this the right to pursue happiness, right? The right to pursue happiness is the right to put your energies to effect, your skills, your knowledge, your strength, into providing for yourself and your family without becoming a burden to others, and allowing yourself to provide for your friends and your family as you see fit. And this right, this common law right, was one of the rights that the radical Republicans intended to protect when they wrote the 14th Amendment in the 1860s. Okay. At the end of the Civil War, the Republican Party in Congress was writing constitutional amendments to try and prevent any future civil war, right? And one of the things that they did was they wrote a 14th Amendment that prohibits states from depriving you of certain rights, including the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States, which is, among other things, the right to economic liberty. That was the state of things in 1868 when the 14th Amendment was written. But in 1873, the Supreme Court of the United States basically erased this provision from the Constitution of the United States. So if you have your Constitution with you, you can take out your pen and scratch out the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States. What happened was there was a case called the Slaughterhouse Cases. The state of Louisiana passed a law saying if you want to slaughter cattle in New Orleans, you have to slaughter them at one privately owned slaughterhouse, the Crescent City Livestock Landing and Slaughtering Corporation, and that's it. It just so happens that stock in this business was owned by members of the state legislature. Right? Louisiana politics hasn't changed much in a century and a half, right? So you would have to imagine, like, if California passed a law that said every automobile in Los Angeles County has to be repaired at AAMCO, right? It put hundreds of small businesses out of business overnight. All these butcher shops in New Orleans Parish, right? New Orleans is a center of the slaughtering industry. Cattle's being brought there to be slaughtered, to be put on ships bound for the East. This is before refrigeration, right? So this puts hundreds of butchers out of business overnight. They file lawsuits. They're put together as a single case, the slaughterhouse cases. And their argument is very simple. The 14th Amendment says no state can deprive us of our privileges or immunities. Privileges or immunities means the common law rights that belong to us traditionally, and that includes the right to earn a living without unreasonable government monopolies. We win. But in fact, they lost. In a 5-4 decision, the Supreme Court of the United States said that the Privileges or Immunities Clause only protects a very narrowly limited set of federally protected rights, such as the right to travel on the high seas. Right. Because that's what the abolitionists were all in a tizzy about, right? All those former slaves, they were taking these cruises to the Caribbean, and Arkansas was sending its navy to stop them or something. No, that's ridiculous, right? The reason for this this constitutional language was to protect the rights of the former slaves to earn an honest living, which was being deprived. They were being deprived of this right by the enactment of black codes in the southern states. Nevertheless, the slaughterhouse cases remains good law today. So, since 1873 to the present day, with only some very minor exceptions, the Supreme Court has never enforced the Privileges or Immunities Clause of the Constitution. It's basically dead letter. So. That leaves, I've got my pigeon case, you know, I threw the thing about privileges or immunities in there knowing that I probably wouldn't, you know, persuade the trial court to overturn the Supreme Court. So I argue also that this law deprives my client of his liberty without due process of law. Due process of law, what does that language mean? Well, it means that you can be deprived of life, liberty, or property if the government does give you due process of law, if it treats you in a lawful manner, right? Government must treat you in a lawful manner. It can't treat you in an arbitrary manner. It can't deprive you of liberty just because it feels like it, right? What is a law? A law is the use of government power in pursuance of some broad principle that promotes the general public welfare, right? It's not just because the government feels like it or just because they have more votes than you do or something, right? Shortly after the election, President Obama famously said in the news, well, we're going to do it my way because we won, right? So we have more votes, so you got to do it our way. Not for any actual reason, just because we have the power. That's an arbitrary use of government power. That's not according to law. I always tell people that if you ever tell your kids, because I said so, you violated the due process of law clause of the 14th Amendment. Not actually, because it's not state action, so it's okay. Anyway, government can't use its power in an arbitrary manner. Now, let's think of a couple of ways that government might use its power arbitrarily. Imagine that Congress passed a law that required you to do something, like clean up your yard or something, right? And the president vetoes it. And the next day, the sheriff shows up on your doorstep, he knocks on your door, why didn't you clean up your yard? you're under arrest because you didn't clean up your yard. You would say, well, no, the president vetoed that. That's not the law. Since he vetoed it, it didn't become law, which means if you arrest me under it, you're depriving me of liberty without due process of law, right? That makes sense. But that's just where some procedural failing made the bill not become law. Is it possible for there to be certain substantive limits? Well, we know there are, right? The Bill of Rights, for among other things, puts substantive limits on what the government can do. So imagine that Congress passed a law that declared Scientology the official religion of the United States, and the president signs it, right? And the sheriff comes up to your doorstep on the weekend. He says, "Why aren't you in church?" You would say, "Well, I'm not a Scientologist." And he would say, "Yes, you are. Congress passed a law." And you would say, "No, they didn't. Congress didn't pass a law. Because the First Amendment says Congress shall make no law that establishes a religion. So Congress has no power to make such a thing into a law. So if you arrest me pursuant to this thing, you are depriving me of liberty without due process of law. Whatever Congress passed, you can call it a bill or a decree or whatever you want, but it's not a law, right? That's where there's an explicit limitation in the Constitution. Are there also certain implicit limits on what government can do to us? Things that the Founding Fathers considered so obvious that they didn't really have to spell it out in the Constitution of the United States? Today, lawyers will say no to that question. Most lawyers today will say government can do anything it wants to us, as long as there's no explicit prohibition in the Constitution. But that's not how the Founding Fathers thought. The Founding Fathers thought government existed for certain reasons, and that legislation by the government that exceeded those reasons or perverted that power was illegitimate, arbitrary, and not lawful. You'd have to imagine, think about government the way the Founding Fathers thought. The Founding Fathers thought of government as like a bank guard, right? So imagine that you own a bank and you're afraid somebody's going to come and rob your bank, so you hire a guard to stand in the corner with his badge and his gun, and your problem is solved, right? Not really. Now you have a new problem, right? There's a guy in your bank with a gun. And what would happen if he took out the gun and robbed the bank for himself, right? And you fire him, and he says, "You can't fire me for that. You didn't put in the contract that I couldn't rob the bank." Right? You would say, "Well, duh. The whole point of hiring a guard was that I wouldn't have my bank robbed." I'm delighted to say I actually found out just recently, there actually is a case on exactly this from the Florida Supreme Court. That there's a bank hired a guard, and the guard conspired with some robbers to rob the bank where he worked. And the bank sued the agency, the employment agency that provided the guard, on a respondeat superior theory. That is, they said that the employment agency was responsible for what the guard did. And the employment agency said, "Well, that's kind of beyond the scope of his employment." And they won, of course. And the Florida Supreme Court said, "Yes, if a bank guard takes out his gun and robs the bank where he works, he's acting outside the scope of his employment, even if you didn't write into the contract, 'By the way, you can't rob my bank.'" Right? Same thing with the government and the Constitution of the United States. We have a government, we hire a government for certain purposes, to protect our rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, to ensure that we are governed by law and not arbitrarily. If government takes out its gun and robs us for its own benefit or for the benefit of its favorite cronies, like in Kelo versus New London, then what the government has done is use its power in an arbitrary, unlawful manner for its own welfare instead of the welfare of the general public, which violates the principles of due process of law. So, getting back to my pigeon case. So I have the government's expert witness there in deposition. This is the guy who basically wrote this law that we're challenging. Oh, very interesting deposition. I said to him, "So this law requires 2 years of training in order to put up spikes on a building to keep pigeons away." He said, "Yes, that's right." I said, "But no training at all to put the same spikes on the same building to keep seagulls away." He said, "Yes, that's right." I said, "Would you call this irrational?" He said, "Yes, I would." And the government's lawyer said, "Can we take a break?" Now, the reason why that's important is The principles that I've talked about due process of law and government having to respect our rights and not exploit its power for its own benefit and welfare, those principles were generally well understood throughout the 19th century. They're the principles behind cases like Lochner versus New York. Now, are there any lawyers in the audience? Yeah, I see they're always shy about raising their hands. They're like, well, if I'm not under oath, I don't have to admit it, you know. The lawyers in the audience know that when I say Lochner, they're supposed to say boo. Lochner is the worst decision ever. That's what they're taught in law school. Lochner is the worst decision in the history of the Supreme Court. Why? Well, what happened in that case was the state of New York made it illegal for bakers to work overtime. Prohibited bakers from working more than 10 hours a day. Why? Well, it turns out there was no evidence that working more than 10 hours a day was bad for bakers or bad for the general public or anything like that. It was just that the government decided to give them more leisure time, because that's what big-hearted liberals do, you see. What big-hearted liberals do is make it illegal for poor people to find jobs and then say, look at all the leisure, the freedom of leisure that we've given to the poor, right? We make it more expensive to hire women and members of minority groups, and then we pat ourselves on the back for our compassion. That's what liberalism is all about. Fortunately, Mr. Amon Schmitter, a baker in New York, wanted to work overtime. He asked his boss. His boss said, okay. And there you go, right? An agreement between two mature adults who own their bodies and own themselves and have the right to decide what they want to do, and it ain't nobody else's business if they do. Nevertheless, it was illegal, and it went up to the Supreme Court of the United States. And the Supreme Court struck down this law as unconstitutional. It said, if two grown adults want to make a contract between themselves, they have the right to do that, and government doesn't have the right to interfere. Unless there's some general good reason. I mean, if they're agreeing to do something dangerous, you know, if they make a contract to murder somebody or something, sure, that should be illegal. But if they decide to work overtime and one guy decides to pay the other guy, it's nobody else's business if they do. Unfortunately, this was during the Progressive Era. And the progressives were a group of intellectuals with radical new ideas. This case was 1905. Progressives were a group of intellectuals with radical new ideas for how government ought to change, how the American constitutional order ought to be revised. They had four big ideas. The first one was, rights are just permissions that government gives to you. The founding fathers thought that rights are ours because we're human beings and no just government may deprive us of those rights. But the progressives decided, no, government gives you rights for its own purposes. And then if it wants to, it can deprive you of those rights. So for example, Oliver Wendell Holmes, the vilest human being ever to serve on the Supreme Court of the United States. I'm convinced the only reason why the legal community allows Holmes to be described as a hero is because they don't actually read his opinions, which are disgusting. He wrote an opinion in a case called Abrams versus United States, and most law professors will tell you that freedom of speech law, today's freedom of speech law, comes out of that decision. The first line, or one of the first lines in his decision in that case is, persecution seems perfectly logical to me. He says, but we don't persecute people because it's good for society to have a debate. So we allow people to debate amongst themselves, but you know, if we want to, we can then throw them in jail when they're done. Like Schenck versus the United States, another opinion that he wrote, where he said that it was okay for the government to throw people in jail for handing out pamphlets on how not to be drafted into the army. That opinion is most famous for the phrase, yelling fire in a crowded theater. Because yeah, handing out pamphlets against the draft is just like yelling fire in a crowded theater. Right? So that was the first progressive idea, was rights are just permissions. The second great progressive idea was government exists to make society nice. That's not what the founding fathers thought. Right? Thomas Jefferson said that the sum of good government is one that shall restrain men from injuring one another and leave them otherwise free to regulate their own pursuits of industry and improvement and not take from the mouth of labor the bread it has earned. But no, the progressives had these great ideas for how government ought to work. We should make society a nice place to live in. So they created laws like eugenics, segregation, prohibition, the income tax, the use of eminent domain for redevelopment was a progressive idea. Zoning laws. Anybody here know what the original purpose of zoning was? To keep racial minorities out of white neighborhoods.
Of course, we never use it for that purpose today, right?
So that was the second great progressive idea, is government makes society nice. The third great progressive idea was judicial restraint, which unfortunately a lot of my conservative friends have adopted. This is the idea that if the legislature violates your rights, courts should do nothing about it. right? Great moments in judicial restraint. Plessy versus Ferguson. State of Louisiana passes a law. Blacks and whites can't sit on the same train cars. The court says, well, we're not going to be activists. We're going to let that go. Right? Korematsu versus United States. The government throws the Japanese Americans in prison camps in World War II. The Supreme Court says, we're not going to get involved. You know, let democracy have its way. Kelo versus New London is a great moment for judicial restraint. Right? The fourth great progressive idea was the living constitution. Bends and stretches to meet the changing needs of the day. It's not worth the paper it's printed on. It means whatever lawyers say it means at that particular moment. So those are the four great progressive ideas. And Justice Brandeis put these ideas very well in one sentence when he said, property and other rights of the individual must be remolded from time to time to meet the changing needs of society. Don't you love that word, remolded? What a great euphemism for violated. Oh no, we're not violating your rights, we're just remolding your rights. When the city comes and steals Suzette Kelo's house and gives it away to a private developer, they're not violating her rights, just remolding her rights. Right? If it can be remolded for society's purposes, it's not a right, it's a permission, it's a privilege. It's something government gives to you, it's not a right. Right? Now these ideas were not very popular right away. It took some time for them to become American constitutional law. It was 1934 when they became American constitutional law in a case called Nebbia versus New York. Now Nebbia is a great case because it's so stupid. So, in Nebbia, this is 1934, right, it's the depths of the Great Depression. You got like 25% unemployment, right? You got these soup kitchens, these bread lines. The solution to this problem is obvious, right? We have to make food more expensive. Duh. So they pass a law that makes it illegal to sell cheap milk. Milk must be at least 8 cents a quart. And a grocer sells milk for less than 8 cents a quart, and he gets brought up on charges, goes up to the Supreme Court of the United States. The Supreme Court says, yeah, you can punish him for that. Because if the government wants to regulate the economy, it can do virtually anything it wants. And this was the creation of what lawyers today call the rational basis test. Rational basis test. The rational basis test says that government can deprive you of your economic freedom as long as it is rationally related to a legitimate government interest. That's the test. Now, very quickly, that does not mean the law has to be rational. Okay? That just means that the judge thinks a politician might have thought that it would be a good idea for the public. Then it's constitutional. I'm not making this up. And it gets worse. It gets worse than that. Because the legislature doesn't even have to have any facts to support its rational conclusion. In fact, the government doesn't have to say why it passed the law. In fact, the judge can invent his own justification for the law, even if the government doesn't make that argument in court. Now, imagine that this were the rule when it comes to criminal law. Imagine that at the end of the trial, the judge says, well, it's true the prosecution didn't prove the case, but I can think of a way you might have done it. Guilty. Right? Oh, I have a gavel. Guilty. Imagine that really is the law. When it comes to government restrictions that deprive you of your right to go into business for yourself, to provide for yourself and your family without unreasonable government interference. That really is the test that applies when government decides to take your house away and give it to Costco to build a shopping center. That really is the test. And it gets even better than that. I said rationally related to a legitimate government interest. What is a legitimate government interest? Anybody? My friend Derek's here in the audience. He knows. What's a legitimate government interest, Derek? Anything the judge wants. In Nolan versus California Coastal Commission in 1987, the Supreme Court of the United States said, our cases have not laid out the standards for determining what is a legitimate government interest. Think about what that means. On the 200th anniversary of the Constitution of the United States, the nation's top lawyers have no idea what government exists to do. And if we don't know what a legitimate government interest is, how do we know whether something's rationally related to it? Isn't that like trying to pick a route, but no destination? If you don't have a destination, any route will do. That's the law when it comes to businesses. So when I was at deposition, and the state's expert witness says to me, yes, the law is irrational, right? I always tell law students the hardest part about a deposition like that is not going, I got you. Right? You have to say, I see. So they go to break. They come back from the break. Government's lawyer says,
or I mean, I'm sorry, the government, the witness says, I'd like to clarify what I said about irrational. I'm thinking, I bet you do, right? He says, what I meant was, from the public's perspective, it's irrational. But see, what originally happened was you needed a license for everything, all pest control work. And then they were going to get rid of the licensing requirement if you didn't use pesticides. And those of us who already had licenses, we didn't want to face competition from newcomers. So we went to the state legislature and we said, can you divide up the market and let us keep the pigeons, the rats, and the mice? Because they're the most common pests. And those guys can deal with the bats and whatnot. And I'm going, tell me more. So I go in front of the trial court right here in San Francisco. I go in front of the federal trial court. I said, Your Honor, it is an undisputed fact in this case that this law is irrational. And we still lost. Because the rational basis test is so biased against business owners, entrepreneurs, people who are trying to earn a living. People who aren't asking for a handout or a bailout just to be left alone, to put their skills to use to provide for themselves and their families. Now, I'm glad to say we won on appeal. We appealed to the Ninth Circuit just down the street. And the court struck down this licensing law and held it unconstitutional. They said government may not use its licensing laws simply to protect one business against fair competition from entrepreneurs. But that's only the third court ever to pronounce on that issue, on whether states can employ their licensing laws in this way. Now, these licensing laws have an extremely important effect in our economy. They burden particularly the small-scale entrepreneur in the less expensive startup businesses. Entrepreneurs in businesses like taxi driving. If you wanted to drive a taxi to earn a living for yourself a century ago, you could have taken your Model T and painted the word taxi on the side, and there you go, right? Nowadays, if you want a license to operate a taxi cab in New York City, it'll cost you $600,000. Now, it ain't rich white guys driving taxi cabs in New York City, right? It's immigrants, it's members of the poorer classes, it's residents of the inner city who need constitutional legal protection for their right to economic liberty. The reason we have a constitution in this country is so that you don't have to have political influence to have your rights respected, right? Ted Turner or Donald Trump, they don't need all this kind of protection. They can hire expensive, really good lawyers, right? They can get their way. They can go down to the legislature and they can talk to the governor and members of the state house. And they can get their way in the law. Taxi drivers in New York City, not so much, right? Entrepreneurs who want to start a pest control business but are told that they have to shut down for 2 years and become an apprentice to learn skills they don't need. Barbers who in California, you basically have to have a college degree to be a barber. Right? Interior decorators in Florida. It's illegal in the state of Florida to call yourself an interior designer without having a college degree. Illegal to call yourself an interior designer. In California, it's illegal to be a landscape architect without a license. I'm allowed to tell you where to plant your roses in your yard, but if you pay me a dollar for that, I can go to jail. Do these laws protect the general public? Of course not. They certainly don't protect the consumer. They make the cost of living higher for all of us in a time when our economy is suffering so much. But most importantly, they place burdens, extremely expensive and difficult and time-consuming burdens, on the hard-working people of this country who want nothing more than to create wealth, to provide for their families and themselves, to create jobs and provide the public with the goods and services that we need. Now, I'm glad to say at Pacific Legal Foundation's Economic Liberty Project, we bring these kinds of cases to vindicate the rights of America's hardest working entrepreneurs. But that's not going to solve this problem, right? Litigation is great. I love suing the government. I went to law school so I could sue the government. I'd sue the government for free if I had to. In fact, I do. I don't charge my clients. But it's not going to change everything. It needs cultural change. What we need in this country is a revival of respect for the wealth creators in our society. We need a revival of respect for the Constitution of the United States. You know, not long ago I heard an interview with Justice Stephen Breyer. He was asked, what's the most important thing about the most important part of the Constitution of the United States? And his answer was, democracy. Where democracy, of course, appears nowhere in the Constitution of the United States. Now, the first sentence of the Constitution declares unambiguously that liberty is a blessing. Never says the same thing about government.
In fact, it goes on for page after page after page to limit government, to limit democracy. Laws have to pass through one house, then another house. The president can veto it. All these restrictions on democracy. Why? To protect liberty. But what we allowed in this country is we allowed progressives to replace liberty with democracy as their central constitutional value. So much so that most lawyers in this country think that liberty is something democracy gives you. When in fact, it's the other way around. The reason we have democracy is to protect liberty. And democracy is only legitimate insofar as it respects liberty. The liberty of freedom of speech, the liberty of freedom of religion, the liberty to use your skills to go into business to provide for yourself and your family without unreasonable interference from the government. Let me finish up by talking about one case that I'm working on right now in Missouri. I represent an entrepreneur in St. Louis named Michael Muni. Runs a moving business in St. Louis, Missouri. He has a state license that allows him to operate within the city of St. Louis. And he has a federal license that allows him to operate across state lines. So he can move your goods from St. Louis into, you know, Illinois or to California or whatever. But he's not allowed to move people within Missouri outside of St. Louis unless he first gets permission from all of the existing moving companies. That's right. In Missouri, if you want to run a moving business, you have to get a license. And when you want to get a license, the State Department of Transportation notifies all the existing moving companies and gives them the chance to veto your application. And when they veto your application, you have to go in front of a government agency and prove that there has to be a new moving company in Missouri. Now, how would you do that? The law doesn't give any guidelines or any standards or any rules of evidence of any sort. But aside from that, how would you go about proving that there needs to be a new moving company? I first went to a Starbucks in 1993. I went on a vacation to Seattle, went to Starbucks, and they said, "Well, this is gonna take the world by storm." I was like, "Yeah, right. It's just coffee, right?" If you had been forced to prove to the country that there needed to be a new coffee shop chain in the country, could you possibly have done that? There were plenty of coffee shops in America, right? But it turned out America needed a new coffee shop. We know that because Starbucks is wildly successful. The only way to learn it is to try it. But under the state law of Missouri, my client is not allowed to try it unless he first gets permission from the existing companies. Now, I'm glad to say that after we filed this lawsuit, the state of Missouri is considering a bill that has now passed both the House and the Senate that would repeal this licensing requirement. So activism does do good, but it can only be a component of a broader cultural shift, and we have to all here be concerned about these issues, be concerned about the philosophical implications, the legacy of the progressive age that taught us that rights are just permissions, that government exists to make society nice, and so forth. Those things are not true. I say we should return to the principles of the Constitution of the United States and to the blessings of liberty. Thank you very much.
Our thanks to Timothy Sandefur, adjunct scholar at the CATO Institute, attorney at the Pacific Legal Foundation, and author of the new book, The Right to Earn a Living, Economic Freedom in the Law. It's now time for today's audience question period, and we have a number of questions, so let's begin. I'm going to use the prerogative of the moderator to ask the first question. You spoke of judicial activism. You spoke of legal training implicitly in your comments about the fact that most lawyers would say government today would say that government can do anything that's not explicitly prohibited, which is actually the inverse of what our founding fathers' understanding was. Now, I'm not a lawyer, and I'm sure that many of our listeners and our viewers on television and listeners on the radio and here in the room today also are not. So I'm wondering if you could explain something. Given that poor judicial decisions gain legitimacy in the common law tradition and thus create bad precedents, what can be done to get us back on track? And what can we do?
That is the best question of all. I'll answer the second question first, and that is, what can you do? You can donate large amounts of money to my employer, the Pacific Legal Foundation, a nonprofit 501c3 organization headquartered in Sacramento, tax deductible. But in a broader sense, it really is education. You know, when I was younger, it always seemed so corny when people would say, you know, children are our future and it's all about education. It really is. I mean, the progressive movement took 50 years to get from being the drawing room philosophy of a group of socialists like John Dewey to become the prevailing law of the United States. And it requires arguments and discussions on a variety of levels, economics, philosophy, politics, law, and history, and so forth. So it's every little bit helps. And understanding the principles of our founding and talking about them and educating our neighbors and our children about them is really very crucial to what we do. As for lawyers, you know, Tocqueville said, although lawyers value liberty, they value order more. So as long as it is the legitimate authority that is depriving men of their freedom, lawyers are more or less content, which is sadly very true. I think that it's going to just be a much more uphill battle in the realm of the law to restore respect for economic liberty. However, I do think that we really do ourselves a disservice when we say that we're trying to restore an older vision of the Constitution. Nothing of the sort, right? America, the sad tragedy of all of American history is how the promises of liberty and equality were never fulfilled for large groups of people throughout American history. And we are today much closer to doing that than any previous generation has been. It's just that we still have a long way to go. I'm saying we need to not to return to the principles of American liberty, but to discover them. Does that answer your question?
It's beautiful. So our next question. Your book, we have several questions based on people who've read your book before they came to hear you speak. Your book places a large amount of blame on progressives for why the government violates the rights of citizens to earn a living. What, if not the government, should be the primary agent of social change in America?
The primary agent of social change in America should be people, not working through coercion, right? People who persuade and talk and argue, that's the system of freedom. That's what the First Amendment and the Constitution of the United States is all about, is that like I'm doing right now, I'm coming to you with my arguments, and you can take them or leave them as you please. I'm not trying to force them upon you. What happened with the Progressive Era was that they confused desirability with implementing it into law, right? What they did was they said, oh, well, we're going to remold your liberty to meet what politicians think are the changing needs of society. And you would never accept that idea if it came to freedom of religion, right? Imagine that the government sets up a religion licensing law and says, well, we've got too many Baptists in town, so you can't be a Baptist anymore unless you first get permission from the Catholics, right? Ridiculous, right? I'm saying that the right to economic liberty is no less valuable than the right of religious freedom. It's every bit as much a part of our liberty as the right of religious freedom. Certainly the Constitution of the United States makes no distinction between these rights. The idea of applying rational basis scrutiny to rights like private property and higher standards of judicial scrutiny to other kinds of rights and protecting some rights more than other rights and everything, that's not to be found in this document. That was invented by the progressives and their New Deal followers out of whole cloth with no basis whatsoever in the American constitutional law tradition. So I'm arguing in favor of freedom. If you think that social change is necessary, by all means, go out and agitate, which is a quote from one of my favorite figures in American history, Frederick Douglass. He was asked, a young man asked him, what should I do with my life, Mr. Douglass? And he said, agitate. But as far as the law tradition in this country is concerned, and the fact that we have 70 years of bad precedent on this issue, I'm reminded of another Frederick Douglass quote. He said, nothing is settled that is not right.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our speaker today is Timothy Sandefur, attorney and adjunct fellow at the CATO Institute, who's discussing government regulations that he says stand in the way of free enterprise. So, on a follow-on to the response you just gave, where do child labor laws, 40-hour work weeks, weekends, etc., fall into our right to run our businesses without government interference? Because this is San Francisco, including race, religion, sex, etc.
I do believe that race is entirely a different matter, because the 13th Amendment, in my interpretation of the 13th Amendment, I share this with Justice John Harlan, whose view was not adopted by the Supreme Court until the 1970s. I do believe that the 13th Amendment prohibits private racial discrimination in contracting. But with regard to child labor laws, et cetera, I will take the shocking position that such laws should all be abolished. And let me explain my reasoning. A law that prohibits child labor in, what was it, 1890 or 1900 or whenever that the federal legislation prohibiting child labor comes in. You know, children don't work because it's fun. Right? Children weren't working in 19th century America because they felt like it. They were working because their families needed the money. Laws that prohibit them from earning a living, that do not compensate them for the lost earning power, only make those families poorer. They do not make them better off. You do not improve the state of the poor man in this country by making his jobs illegal. Nevertheless, that has been the route in American legal history for a long time. Oh, we're going to show our big-hearted compassion by making it more expensive or illegal to hire people for jobs that they are willing to take and that they need. Now, I believe that in today's world, a large part of child labor legislation is really unnecessary and gets in the way of perfectly harmless child labor, right? Kids can't get jobs, you know, cutting lawns and things because they have to be 16 and all this sort of thing. And I think all of our child labor laws, at the very least, need to be updated to meet the needs of our present day. I think they're very archaic at this state. But I think any law that makes jobs harder to get, or makes food more expensive, or anything along those lines, I think we should be very skeptical of those things. And it always shocks me how the left is perfectly happy to adopt these laws. I don't understand. I wish that I could talk to my liberal friends about this and say, look, if you think that evil, greedy corporations are so evil and greedy, why in the world would you trust government more? Right? Let's say you're right. Let's say that that business is evil and corrupt and greedy and nasty and does all these terrible things. There's no doubt there are many evil corporations out there, right? The most famous evil corporation in the world today is the Bin Laden Corporation, right? There's all sorts of nasty corporations. Why would you believe that government is somehow not corrupt or not greedy or not dangerous? I can at least sue a corporation. I can at least shop somewhere else. I can refuse to pay them, right? You can't do any of those things with the government. If the government does a bad job, they get their money anyway, right? Yet the left has this blind spot in this country about how government operates. They think that it's staffed by angels, I guess. But the fact is, if government has the power to redistribute wealth and resources from one group of people to another, that power is worth a tremendous amount of money. Right? If I have the power to take $1 million from one group of people and give it to another group of people, that power is worth $1 million. Which means people are going to invest their time and their money trying to get control over that power for their own use. Right? And who's going to win that competition? Not the morally deserving, the politically influential. And who's the politically influential? The very same evil, greedy corporations that you started out to limit. Right? There's a reason why Bel Air isn't getting condemned through eminent domain for redevelopment. Right? Because the people who live there can afford to prevent it. Anybody here from Southern California? You know, in Pasadena, you know the 710 freeway? Right? They've been trying to build the 17 freeway extension for, what, 30, 40 years? And they still haven't. There's still like this three blocks where you have to get off the freeway and drive city streets and then get back on the freeway. Why? Because that's where the rich people live. So they've held up construction of this freeway, right? If you go down to bad neighborhoods in this country, particularly neighborhoods that are where people who live who are members of racial minorities or immigrant groups, they don't have that kind of political influence. If you believe that the poor in this country need more protection, if you believe in allowing people to realize what's best within them without the barriers that are imposed upon them by others, you should be as skeptical of government, if not more so, than you are of any corporation. So my answer is, yes, I would love it if children didn't have to work. I would love it if nobody had to work. But the fact is, in the 19th century, children had to work because the situation was that bad. And you don't make the situation better by taking their jobs away and not compensating them for the lost earning time that their families needed.
So we have two questions here, and they're related, so I'm going to ask them both at the same time. What advice do you have for President Obama regarding potential changes in tax laws and how those could impact potential liberty? And corollary, what advice do you have for California Governor Jerry Brown regarding any moves to increase taxation in California?
My advice to all politicians is resign immediately. I actually got a letter from my congressman one time, one of these form letters that says, you know, if you have any ideas on how to create jobs and improve the economy. So I wrote back advising him to retire. And he never wrote back. Well, the simple answer is I think what we need is a flat tax. We need a tax that taxes everybody at a flat percentage of their income and leave it at that. Even that, is the least bad of the options. But what we have in the current situation is, first of all, it's so incredibly confusing. You know how much it costs businesses just to do the paperwork for our taxation in this country? It's just ridiculous. And every year it changes. But there's also these built-in incentive systems into the tax code that make people do things that they really shouldn't be doing, right? I myself benefit every year from the home mortgage interest deduction. I love that dang thing, right? Because I bought a house at the top of the market. This was my brilliant investment strategy. You see, buy a $420,000 house that's worth $380,000 now. And that way, since it's an interest-only mortgage, then, right? I have no business being in this house. The government is basically paying to keep me in this house. Thank you, all of you, right? So the bottom line is we should have a taxes if we have any taxes. All taxes should be written in such a way that they do not change the incentives of that change our behavior. Flatten the tax code, make it as simple as possible, and eliminate, well, since I think most of what government does is unconstitutional anyway, it would be rather easy for me to balance the budget if I were made king for a day.
Well, speaking of unconstitutionality, if government is not meant to be able to exploit us for its own benefit, then why have government unions not been challenged as unconstitutional?
Yeah, well, I don't know whether they have or not been challenged as unconstitutional. I think government unions are a terrible idea and should be abolished immediately, simply on Republican principle, I mean with a small r, on the principle of self-government. What government unions do is create a government class, a class of people whose interests are explicitly adverse to the interests of the general public, right? What is a labor union? A labor union is a cartel that is designed to force consumers to pay more by withholding labor, right? Now, any cartel works this way. You and I agree we're not going to work for John Smith unless he pays us $20 an hour. Well, the problem with that is now it's in my best interest to say, yeah, I'm not going to work for him unless he pays us $20 an hour. And then I sneak in the back door and say, look, I'll work for you for $15 an hour, right? So it creates this defection scenario. So what unions have to do is they have to prevent that kind of defection. And the way they do it is primarily through violence or the threat of violence, or by closed shop rules, or by simply using the law to force people to pay them. This Wisconsin debacle that's going on. I saw these people complaining about how, it's all just funded by the evil Koch brothers. Yeah, the Koch brothers at least chose to donate their money to these groups. Members of the labor unions don't have any choice in the matter. They're forced to pay, right? Even if you say, I would rather the union not spend my money on political campaigns, you get like $5 back, right? So this money is stolen from them, from workers by the state to benefit a greedy corporation that we call a union. Right? Another one of these blind spots. What is a union? A union is a greedy corporation that exploits the working class for the benefit of its leadership. That's what it is. And when you allow a labor union to be the monopoly on labor that the government has to go to, that means that the monopoly on labor can dictate terms to the government and say, if you want government workers, you have to do X, Y, and Z. Right? None of us should have that situation in a government that's supposed to be of, by, and for the people. What labor unions do is create a class, a government class in this society who has a vested interest in expanded and protecting the powers of government as opposed to what's actually in the best interests of the general public. And then, of course, they say, well, what about the children? And, you know, all these sorts of emotionalistic appeals to feelings and things without actually making the argument of why they should get six-figure pensions for doing nothing, right? So my answer is, I think all government employee unions should be abolished. But I don't know about, I don't know the constitutional law that relates to them.
So we're basically stuck with multi-generational taxation without representation until someone takes that on?
Yeah, well, welcome to California. Oh, let's build a bullet train. Why not? My grandchildren will pay for it, right? What do I care about future generations? What have they ever done for me? I stole that joke, I admit.
So in your book, you lament that it's hard to secure economic rights when business owners and property owners have largely failed to stand up for themselves. So what future do you think economic rights will have?
Well, I think that, look, this goes back to what I said about how if you distrust evil, greedy corporations, you should distrust government more. The biggest fraud that the American people have allowed to be perpetrated upon them is the idea that big business likes free markets. Big business hates free markets. Big business has always hated free markets. Big business has stopped at nothing to exploit government power, to protect itself from fair competition, to force us to pay more for products and services we need, right? That's what big business does. The whole reason liberals should favor free markets is because what free markets do is take the gun out of the hands of evil, greedy corporations. Evil, greedy corporations love big government. So I don't think that you're going to see businesses standing up for economic liberty anytime soon. And if you do, it's going to be small business. It's going to be entrepreneurs, individual workers. Now, fortunately, I think technology and the service economy is favoring more and more small businesses and individual entrepreneurs. And so I think you're going to see a lot more people standing up for their right to earn a living for themselves and running their own business. But I think that, you know, as far as big business is concerned, big business, with very few heroic exceptions, is nothing but compromise, 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 compromise. Sell out, sell out, sell out, sell out. They don't care about freedom. It's expensive, right? Freedom isn't free, so big businesses don't like it, right? It costs a lot of money to defend, and it doesn't benefit them. There's no money to be made in fighting eminent domain abuse, right? I work for a nonprofit. We've got 20 people, right? Costco has entire staffs of people whose only job is to go to city councils and say, you know, you should use eminent domain to steal this guy's property and give it to us. And we'll build a Costco there, and we'll get rich, and you politicians, you'll all look like visionaries. And the only people who suffer are those stupid homeowners, and who cares about them, right? They're going to forget by the time election day comes around. You have a triangle trade then. A system that benefits politically well-connected big businesses and politicians at the expense of citizens. Once again, if liberals really care about individuals, they should favor free markets, right? But you're not going to see leadership on economic liberty coming from big business with very few exceptions. What you're going to see is Eisenhower warned us about the military-industrial complex. We have the government-big business complex, and you're going to see them feeding each other consistently. Obamacare is another great example, right? If you want to provide health insurance to everybody in this country, you could just tax them and then take that money and provide government-provided health care, right? We already do that, the VA, right? But that's not what Obamacare does. What Obamacare does is it forces you to buy insurance from a private corporation and then requires the private corporation to provide you with coverage. That way, when the system fails, the government can point at the private corporation and say it's your fault, and the private corporation can point at the government and say it's your fault. And the taxpayers will be stuck with nothing, right? So no, we're not going to see leadership on economic liberty coming from big business because big business hates economic liberty. You're going to see, if you see any progress, you're going to see progress when people realize that economic liberty is the most proletarian value of all.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our speaker today is Timothy Sandefur, attorney and adjunct fellow at the CATO Institute, who's discussing government regulations that he says stand in the way of free enterprise. So you had mentioned earlier that in response to the question about what can we do, that one of the most important things was to educate ourselves on these principles, the principles of our founding and many of the concepts that you've been discussing today. Obviously, buying your book is one of the first steps in educating ourselves. But in addition, for those in the audience who are autodidacts and would like to follow up on that, what resources would you suggest?
You know, I've got actually a list on PLF's weblog. You can find us online at plf.typepad.com. And so you can look this up. Just look for, just Google Tim the Lawyer's book recommendations and you'll find it. on history, okay. Certainly the Founding Fathers' history, and the best book on the American Revolution is probably Patriots by A.J. Langouthe, but that mostly talks about the history itself, not the ideas. I would read Jefferson. His original writings are so clear and comprehensible that you don't really need an interpreter, but if you do want an interpreter, get Alf Mapp's wonderful two-volume biography of Jefferson. That's M-A-P-P. Read Madison, read The Federalist. On economics, read a wonderful book called Economics in One Lesson by Henry Hazlitt. Marvelous little book. It's like 150 pages, and it really will teach you economics in one lesson. It's really an awesome little book. On liberty and morality, I'm very much an admirer of the work of Ayn Rand. Capitalism, the Unknown Ideal is a marvelous book. Another book that's not very well known today is called The Discovery of Freedom by Rose Wilder Lane. She was actually the daughter of Laura Ingalls Wilder of Little House on the Prairie fame. She wrote a wonderful book on liberty called The Discovery of Freedom. There's a new book by a fellow Cato guy named Tom Palmer, wonderful book called Realizing Freedom, which is a little bit tough, but only in places. I very highly recommend it. And as far as the Constitution is concerned, I would say, although I disagree with him on a lot of things, he's by no means a free market libertarian, Akhil Lamar's two books, The Bill of Rights and America's Constitution, A Biography, are masterpieces. If you want to really understand the Constitution, start with those two books, The Bill of Rights and America's Constitution by Akhil, that's A-K-H-I-L, Amar. Wonderful books. And then, of course, Randy Barnett wrote a book called Restoring the Lost Constitution. And if you want, just even if you disagree with it, but you want to understand the libertarian interpretation of the Constitution, that's really the best place to start for just a general overview of how we libertarians understand the Constitution. It's called Restoring the Lost Constitution by Randy Barnett.
And for radio listeners who might be driving when they hear this, they can always go to the internet and find your talk and take notes. Unfortunately, we've reached the point in our program where there's time for only one last question. So, this was obviously drafted by an attorney, and I'm not sure where it's going to take us, but I'll just read it as written. Talk about the significance of Yik Wo versus Hopkins, an 1886 San Francisco case in which the U.S. Supreme Court differed with California's Supreme Court.
I will tell you, Yik Wo is one of the great cases in American constitutional history. What happened was the city of San Francisco, this was in the 1880s, right? California never had slavery, but we had something very close to it. We had the Chinese, and Californians hated the Chinese, particularly in San Francisco. There's another wonderful book that you should get called Driven Out, which is just a history of the anti-Chinese race wars in 19th century California. What happened was in Yik Wo, the city of San Francisco passed an ordinance that said if you want to run a laundry business, it has to be built out of brick, not out of wood, because it's a fire thing. You know, we're afraid there'll be fires. And you have to get a license from the licensing agency. And there were absolutely no guidelines for determining when you got a license or not. It was entirely subjectively determined by the guy who filled out the licenses, right? And the Supreme Court struck this law down. They said, yeah, you know, you're not going to fool us by this whole it's a fire ordinance thing. This law is really intended to put the Chinese out of work and try and punish them. It was one of a series of such laws that were passed in California at the time. In fact, the 1878 California Constitutional Convention was basically organized to kick the Chinese out of Californians. And it originally included a provision that prohibited any Chinese person from having a job in California. If a corporation hired a Chinese person, it would forfeit its assets. That ended up not in the California Constitution, but the legislature then passed a whole bunch of laws, and the courts struck them down, like in Yik Wo. And so it's really a model of how restrictions on economic liberty hurt the poor and members of disenfranchised racial minorities the hardest, right? Whites passed this law to prohibit the Chinese from going into the laundry business because they had the political power to do so. right? It was an arbitrary exploitation of government power to benefit themselves at the expense of the politically disenfranchised and was therefore unconstitutional. My hero, California Supreme Court Justice Stephen Field, the first Californian ever to serve on the U.S. Supreme Court, was responsible for one of these cases where San Francisco passed a law that required any prisoner who was thrown in jail to have his hair cut off. And they said, oh, it's a lice thing. We want to prevent lice, right? But actually what it was the Chinese had these long queues, these long braids that they really prized. And it was just another way of punishing the Chinese. Well, they passed special taxes prohibiting the Chinese from doing certain work unless they paid an exorbitant tax. And if you couldn't afford the tax, you got thrown in jail and got your hair cut off, right? So Justice Field invalidated this law under the Constitution. So what happened was during that period, you saw a lot of protection of the Chinese against racially discriminatory laws that took the form of restrictions on economic liberty. Once again, the laws that restrict economic liberty benefit the politically well-entrenched at the expense of their competitors. And that has time and time and time again taken the form of racial discrimination in this country. Once again, this is why liberals need to take the issue of economic liberty so seriously. The people who suffer when the Constitution and the courts refuse to protect economic freedom are the poor and members of racial minority groups.
Our thanks to Timothy Sandefur, adjunct scholar at the CATO Institute, attorney at the Pacific Legal Foundation, and author of the new book, The Right to Earn a Living, Economic Freedom and the Law. We also thank our audience here as well as on the radio and the internet. This program has been part of the Commonwealth Club's American Values series underwritten by the Tobey Family Foundation. I'm Deborah England, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know, is adjourned.